Hi, and welcome to this Introduction to Canyoneering presentation. This will be an accelerated version of the one I gave at the University of Scouting this morning, February 21st. And as I said, this is not intended to be really a training for canyoneering, more just to let you know what it's all about. And my main goal, actually, is to persuade you that you need more training before you take scouting groups, especially on canyoneering. So, with that in mind, let's get started. First off, quickly, my bio. I'm a climber, I'm a mountaineer. I've done a lot of canyons, technical canyons, but I haven't done enough of the advanced technical canyoneering and using this, the gear that I'll talk about in this presentation, for me to even call myself a canyoneer. So I'm waiting for more experience for that. So just to let you know, even though I've been climbing for decades, you know, climbed 18,000 foot mountains, canyoneering is a whole beast, a whole challenge, exciting thing in and of itself. I've been a search and rescue volunteer since 99 here in Utah County. I wrote 75 search and rescue stories. You can pick that up at Amazon if you want, at bit.ly/rescue stories. And I've been on a bunch of TV and radio and stuff like that. All right, about canyoneering. So there are basically two kinds. And at the most elemental level, it's just about moving through a canyon. And the term canyoneer was coined by John Wesley Powell back in 1969 as he was exploring the Colorado Plateau. And so something even as simple as, like, here's the Grand Canyon when we did rim to rim. It's just a big long trail, just backpacking with some really beautiful scenery, but not what you'd usually think of as canyoneering. But anything, you know, canyoneering, it can count. And they have this rating system for them. So let me describe to you the five different elements of the rating system. You only see four of them here. So the first one, that one, that's class one. And it goes class one through four. And a one is just hiking. It's not technical. No ropes required. Then class two is basic canyoneering. And it would include some scrambling, easy climbing or down climbing, maybe ropes for hand lines or belays or lowering your pack or something like that, but not really technical. And then in class three, now it begins to get technical. You're rappelling, maybe some technical climbing or down climbing, so you're going to need some ropes, and you can't, once you go down, you can't necessarily just go back up. And then class four is advanced canyoneering. This is where it gets really serious. Aid climbing, multi-pitch rappels, lots of other technical skills, difficult potholes, high-risk climbing, really difficult anchors, long rappels. This is the place where you're more likely to die. And I'm going to say that several times throughout this because I want to impress on your mind that this is serious stuff. Don't go places and don't take scout groups where it's over your head. Make sure you know what you're doing and stay out of trouble. So that's one. The second thing, the letter there, that A, this is where you talk about the water on the route. And you can have A, B, or C. So A is basically a dry route. And dry means there could actually be standing pools of water. Like, there's a picture of me in Mystery Canyon in Zion. Sorry, not Mystery, that's Pine Creek. And the water was low this time, and so we had to wade through it, but it wasn't high enough, we had to swim. So it did not add an ounce of technical difficulty. So that's, I'm going to call that an A in this instance, you know, this time I went, because it didn't add technical difficulty. So if there was deep water, we had to swim, and it did add some technical difficulty, but it was just standing water, that would be a B. And if you have moving water, that makes it tougher, like waterfalls with all the noise they create and slipperiness and figuring things out. If you have water pounding down your head, that's going to change things. So that would be a C. And then the grade, the time required for it, that's that third item there. So a 1 just means it's a few hours. A 2, maybe half a day. A 3, and this is all done in Roman numerals, as you see, most of a day. A 4 is a long day, so dawn till maybe you're hiking out in the dark. So bring headlamps. You should always bring headlamps, probably in almost most. place anyway, but a 5, that's more than a day, usually 2, and a 6 is 2 full days or more, and then I guess you go to a 7 if it's getting really complex or something like that. And then those stars you see there, that's just for popularity, so 3 stars just means this is a great route, you're going to love it, it's a lot of fun. And the one that's missing would be right before those stars. You could have an R if there's a risk. If it's risky, if they're tricky little things where you could get injured. And it could be any kind of things, water or climbing, you know, trickiness or whatever. And an X, that's extreme. So that's a lot of dangers, some really serious dangers. You better not be taking scouts on anything with an X. And maybe not anything with an R unless you guys have a lot of experience. Anyway, let's get on then to technical canyoneering. This is what people more often think of when it's not just hiking. And so basically a class 3 or 4. And here's a shot in Mystery Canyon in Zion, beginning at rappel. And here's one in Bihunin, also in Zion. And so this one, you rappel down, you're going to land in that big lake. Unless on the bottom you kind of run back and forth on the wall until you get over that sand and then just drop as quick as you can. But notice that once you have one person down, if one person solves that problem, then it's solved for the whole group because they can swing the next rappeller over and let them drop on the sand. And there's the exit of Mystery Canyon. Whenever I see this one, I always think of a friend who did Mystery and rappelled down. And when he got to the bottom there in the Zion Narrows, there was a tourist, and he was so angry. He was just livid. And he kept saying, "Nobody told me I could do that." So, anyway. So Mystery, you could say it, actually, you know what, I listed here in my presentation as a 3, because it's, you know, about half a day, and a B, because there's some standing water, but I realized, you know what, that should really be just a, because the water there's not a lot of them moving, it really doesn't complicate it, so that should be an A. And, 3 for technical, 2 for, you know, about half a day, maybe a little longer when you include the approach and driving around and everything, but it's not a huge canyon. 3 stars, no X's or R's. All right, moving on, let's talk about some of the skills you'll need. So rappelling, and let me just point out, a canyon is not the place to teach your boys to rappel, because if they don't have any experience, if they're scared, if they let go of their brake hand, if they get injured or something like that, then this is not a place in the middle of all these ups and downs. You know, you're going to have to get yourself out or get rescued. So make sure you get some good experience before you go there. And climbing may or may not be required. Here I should point out that it can be often really handy to bring someone small in your group. Oh, with rappelling, let me mention group size is a huge consideration, because if you've got 10 people, you get to an anchor, you got to stop and wait for everyone to rappel down. It can really slow up the system. So if you have more leaders, people who know what they're doing, then some of them go ahead and set up the next rappel, and you can keep things moving along pretty smooth. Okay, with climbing, if you bring along someone small, that can be really useful, because you can use everyone, if you have some little climb, to kind of lift them up. And I'll talk about more reasons why it's good to have somebody small. And they have a saying, you recognize this maybe from Lord of the Rings, nobody tosses a dwarf. So if you have a small person, you're kind of throwing them somewhere, toss the dwarf. Sometimes they say that in canyoneering. Swimming, make sure your kids, if you're going to be in somewhere that requires swimming, not only should you know how to swim, but plan to deal with it. Do you have appropriate wetsuits? There were a couple guys who went down to Escalante, I think, area several years ago, and they had 3 mil thin wetsuits that were shorties, and it was a really wet year, so there's a lot of really cold water. And to make a long story short, I'll include some links to some of these stories, by the way, on the page on Utah Highways where I have this. They apparently got to a spot where it was technical, it was difficult to get out, but they died there can only suppose it was because they had hypothermia or they're getting cold, made everything more complex. And I just want to drill these thoughts into your head to take canyoneering seriously.
here's how they found them. There was another group from Montana who came through, 8 or 10 people, and they found a rope laying across a log jam, and they said, oh, maybe we can use this, and they pulled on it, and guess what came up with it? A foot. And then they kind of freaked out, let it go. When they pulled it back up, the body was no longer attached, but they were able to help search and rescue find out where to go pick them back up. So water gets cold down there. In summer, it can be nice and refreshing, but down the bottom of the canyon, it's often really cool. So prepare and do things like if you have your dry bag in your pack, kind of inflate those, get as much air as you can so they'll float, and then you can use that as flotation and some other ways as well. Route finding. You know, you get online and you read and it says, go down this canyon, turn at this point, rappel here, and you think, okay, no problem. But you get there, and it can be really difficult to recognize where you're going, and you can make mistakes. There was a couple in Zion, and they were going to the subway, one of the best-known canyons. Well, they somehow got off route, and they went to rappel down this cliff or something on webbing, and they were in the wrong place. Not only that, but their webbing was too short. So the guy fell, I think about 15 feet, and got some pretty good injuries. And then the girl followed him. I don't know why at this point, really. Oh, well. She followed him. She also got some injuries and some lacerations. But then, and the webbing was too short, so they obviously couldn't go back up, and they couldn't go down. And luckily, the register, you know, with the backcountry permits, they recognized, they knew where they were, they went and looked for them, they found them, and it's a good thing the next day it just downpoured torrentially. So, do good route finding. Here's one more story on that. My friend Anne, actually, this happened to her. She was in Zion, and she went on the right fork of North Creek, which is a 3-day, it's beautiful, it's awesome, but there's this one spot where it's so easy to get lost. It's just cliffs and drops and stuff everywhere. Well, they took the wrong way. And they went down a few rappels, and then they realized they were totally in the wrong place because there was something too big to go down again, and they could not go back the way they came. And so they were trapped. They'd started on Wednesday, and on Monday they didn't show up for work, and they called the park on Tuesday, and they went out looking for them. And here's what saved their lives. They had one of those silver space blankets, and she put rocks on the corners to hold it out, and a helicopter flying over it saw that reflection down in the canyon, and that's what saved their lives. Thank heavens. And they went and pulled them out. But this can be scary stuff, see? So you have maps, GPS, and get really familiar with it, etc. Problem solving. This happens. Things go wrong. You know, entropy. What is that, the second law of thermodynamics? If you're outside long enough, things are going to fall apart on you, and you're going to have to get yourself out. So get some experience, get some training, get some skills so you can solve those problems when they happen. Specialized gear. There's so much stuff that belongs really only to canyoneering. It's great. For example, keeper potholes, one of the biggest fears, one of the scariest things in canyoneering. You drop into a hole, and all of a sudden you can't get out. So one trick you can do is the pack toss. You tie your pack onto a rope, and you throw it out of the hole. And hold on to the other end of the rope, of course, if that's even possible. You love losing it. And then that lands, and there's some friction, and that can give you enough purchase possibly to help yourself get up out. So they also have these pot shots, which are made specifically for this. Reinforced nylon webbing and everything around it. You just fill it up with sand, and however much you need, and if it's a far throw, you know, less sand, whatever, and you chuck it, and hopefully either it gets caught on something, some crack or a chalk stone, or just the friction even can give you some. And even the rope laying across the rock, that gives you a great amount of friction, and that can help. And so you can use those to help yourself climb up out of a pothole. They have similar things called sand traps. They're just big squares. You kind of pile sand in and fold them over in a diamond, and then you can use this either to get out of a hole, or you can use it for an anchor to rappel in. And if you're rappelling in, then here's what you do. You fill it up, you lay it down nice, and then you back it up. You have everybody else kind of tied it, or at least holding onto the rope, and then send somebody down. Not your lightest person. Send down your heavier people, and just make sure it's going to work with that backup. And then send your lightest person down first after you've already tested and proven it, and you know no problem. It's going to be okay for that weight. And then don't shock load it. Don't, like, jerk back. instead just sit down on the lip and just kind of ease yourself off. Keep all that friction there. Don't lift up on the rope and lose all the rope drag from that. That would come in handy. And then, of course, make sure that you're going to be able to pull your anchors after you when you're done with them. This is called ghosting, where you don't drill bolts and you don't leave webbing tied around things. You don't leave any trace of where you've gone. Potshots realize that if you chuck them into water, if they're sitting in water, the sand may drain out of those, so keep that in mind. Also, going through potholes, if you put some people down into a pothole, don't put everybody in. Don't get rid of your rope, your backup plan, where you could escape backwards if you need to for some reason, until you've got somebody out the other side. And, in fact, if you've come to a pothole that you've got to go down into and back out of, maybe before you even go in, see if you can chuck your rope and get it fixed on the far side so you know you have an exit already planned. Can you see how some of these things are things that you wouldn't necessarily figure out if you just went there without experience or without some training? So this is, you know, planning ahead and thinking of what to do and how to deal with things. Here's another piece of gear. This is the fiddlestick, and you can make these if you want. Maybe you could make them with materials on the fly if you need it. But you'd use this with a stone knot. It's actually a hitch. And a hitch, you know how that differs from a knot, is that a hitch has to go around something, like around a post or around this fiddlestick. And when you pull that stick out, your knot dissolves into nothing. So you can use this first. I'm not going to go into any detail, of course, in this overview training. But you can use this to rappel, and then you have a long cord, just a little 3 mil or whatever, tied to that, so you can yank that out and then bring the rope down after you. Other gear to keep in mind, dry bag, quick dry clothing. Do not wear cotton, because if you get wet, that just steals your heat and it doesn't dry forever. We call that killer cloth, so don't even wear that for your underlayers. Be careful what you bring, a sweater or something like that after a swim, even in summer, you know, it can get quite cool, so be prepared for that sort of thing. Ropes, make sure it's long enough. I have some ranger friends down in Zion, and I've gone canyoneering with them several times, and they actually have ropes cut to the lengths for the most common popular canyons there. So make sure that your rope is long enough, or twice as long if you're going to double rope rappel it on spot, so you can drag that after you. Gloves for everybody. All the basic climbing stuff. Helmets are a great idea if you're going anywhere where there's fall or rock fall potential. Slings. Anyway, lots of other stuff. Ascenders like Tiblocks or Prussics, and know how to use those in case you need to ascend a rope. All good things. And then let's talk of a few of the techniques. I've mentioned some already, but sometimes if you need to go up something, you can kind of climb on somebody's shoulders. They can lift you, so there's where the lightweight people come in. If you're in water and you need to get out and you can't touch the bottom, woo, that's really a lot trickier. So some of the things you can do there are you can, you know, get your packs as floaty as possible, and then you have some people swimming, just swimming and pushing those against the wall as well as they can, and then your lightest person or your climber gets up on top of that and tries to use that as a place to either climb up out or maybe throw a pot shot from. So anyway, there are other techniques like that. All right, let's go on to, let me just mention a couple of the really popular local destinations. So there's one, the first one that comes to mind is Little Wild Horse and Bell Canyons, and you can do these in a loop. And it's really near Goblin Valley, like right before you hit Goblin Valley, you turn right, and they've paved that road now. It's somewhere between 5 and 7 miles, somebody said 6 today, and then the pavement ends, and it's great. You walk up that wash, and you turn right at the, and there's a big rock with tons of tiny little cairns on, and that's a Little Wild Horse. And it's maybe 4 miles up to the very top of that if you don't do the whole loop, and then the whole loop, I think it's 8 miles. Somebody told me it was 6, but I don't think it's that short. And it's gorgeous. It's so beautiful. It's really easy. There's a little bit of scrambling and stuff, but it's really, it's one of the most accessible, beautiful canyons you're going to find. So I highly recommend that. 1AV, do you remember what that is? One? Class 1. That's just hiking. A, what's that? No water. And V, I'm not sure it's really a V. That's not right. It only takes a couple hours, actually. So it really should have been a 2. And it should have 3 stars on there, too. It's excellent. Spooky and Peekaboo, these are down in Escalante, and their Spooky is amazing. It's so narrow. It's totally gorgeous in the soft sandstone, but it's so short, and Peekaboo, too. They're really the same length, pretty much. They're so short. Don't drive all the way down there just for these, but if you happen to be down there for Calf Creek Falls or one of their other features, then by all means, find a map, drive out there, hike about a mile, and go through those because they're great. Now, if you want to get into a technical one. There's a, see that 3 repelling? This is barely a 3. Keyhole Canyon in Zion. It's, I mean, look it up online, but it's, you drive up through the tunnel and it's just past there a little ways before Checkerboard Mesa. And there's 1 rappel to get in, and then there's some swimming. And it's really short, just so it's a great beginner one to just kind of get your feet wet and have a tiny bit of experience with that. And then right next to it, this goes down right next to the tunnels, those little windows coming out pretty much, Pine Creek. This is incredible. It's amazing. And as long as the water's not flowing high or anything, it's really spectacular. Great rappels, long exit, short, no big hikes in or anything. It's awesome. And then another one in Zion, Mystery Canyon. So you go past, I think, Ponderosa Ranch, and you drive, and if the road's closed, you might have to hike a little ways. And the key here is to get into the right drainage. So there's a picture of the drainage. I don't know how much that helps. I had some friends who went into the wrong drainage once, and they ran into some problems. But it's got a couple long rappels, including that gorgeous last one into the narrows for the exit. So what do you think that one's rated? So 3 for, you know, some technical. And really, oh yeah, we already discussed this, didn't we? No running water, just a little bit of standing water. Doesn't make it more technical. So A, and half a day or most of a day, so 4 or 5 or something, and definitely 3 stars. It's great. All right, let's talk about some of the dangers. Number 1, no jumping. You come off a little rock, it's 5 feet down to some sand. What are you going to do? Your scouts, of course, they're going to jump because that looks fun. You've got to impress their minds not to do that. Because this is one of the ways where people get injured the most. Break a leg, twist an ankle, and now you're in big trouble. Not because you're twisted an ankle, that's not a big deal, but because you're in the middle of nowhere and it's hard to get you out and all. So don't, you really try and avoid this. Look up. When you look up, what do you see? Well, the most dangerous maybe would be like falling rocks, so make sure don't knock some of those down on top of you. But maybe more importantly is the weather. So if you happen to be in a canyon, maybe the skies are blue above you, but if it drains an area, you know, even far away, and there's a storm there, you could have yourself a little flash flood and be in all kinds of trouble. So pay really close attention to the weather and what's going on. Then look down. When you look down, consider what might be there. If you're jumping into water, do you know what's under there? Are there logs? Are there rocks? Things you might hit? Later I'm going to tell you a story about somebody who jumped down to help someone else actually hit their head. That person's dead now. This is serious stuff, so watch for those hazards. If there are log piles you got to go over, they can be unstable and slippery. If the water's moving, if there's really any kind of force and it wraps you around some kind of log or stick, a strainer, they're surprisingly difficult to get yourself out of. So watch out for those. And then keeper potholes, we've already talked about some of the strategies for dealing with those. And notice that with these potholes, if the water is lower, maybe it's harder to get out. Maybe if the water was higher, you could just swim right over it. So you've got to find out if high water is good or bad in your particular canyon. Look all around. By this one, I mean map skills, route finding. We talked about that a little bit. And have a plan when you're going into a pothole. You know, the big picture for finding the route and also every little obstacle. If one thing doesn't work, then what's your plan B? And even a plan C. Have some ideas of some strategies for making things work. The black hole, the one in Right Fork of North Creek, there's an area of, you know, we have to swim through some cold water. If you really don't want to do that, there's a way around it. So there's one little example of multiple plans. Bring the 20 essentials. And by this, like in my search and rescue book, I think I have like the 19 essentials one chapter, because there are a lot of other things besides just the 10, which is not any kind of standardized list that you ought to have with you often. But what I mean in this case is bring extra of things. Bring some extra food in case you get caught and have to spend longer than you thought. Some extra clothing in case somebody else's clothing gets wet. Your warm stuff, your dry clothing could save their life. So be prepared for that kind of stuff. Batteries, lights, even, you know, if you go into any canyon that's even a 4, you know, you think you're going to spend a lot of the day, I really hope you have a headlamp, because sometimes things do take longer. Someone gets injured, some other obstacle, you're going to be glad you had a light. Communication, you know, your cell phone, if you're down in a canyon, you're probably not going to get any reception. But maybe you can get to some high point and get out. And if you can't make a call, try sending a text, because a text takes a lot less connection than a voice call, so you may be able to get out. Radios can be nice, even just for within your group, communicating back and forth. Like if there's a waterfall and it's really loud, that may help you out. The spot, the PLB, personal locator beacon, quite a popular thing. Don't abuse it. Like the people in the Grand Canyon who triggered it, the SAR Rangers went down. They're like, what's up? They're like, our water tastes funny. They're like, oh, man. Well, later they triggered it again, and I can't remember what their second complaint was, but it was equally inane. And the third time they triggered it, they're like, all right, get in the helicopter. You're coming out right now. So, but you're not stupid, right? You wouldn't do that anyway. So I had a friend on the local SAR team, actually. Spencer recently was in a canyon, and somebody twisted their ankle pretty good. So he had a spot, and he triggered the emergency thing, and the local emergency services got the message. And DPS, the Department of Public Safety, I think, helicopter happened to be nearby. And so they just had to climb up the injured person up this little hillside, and they got a really rapid rescue. It was awesome. But usually rescues take hours or days, because they got to mobilize the team, who are probably volunteers, a lot of them, a lot of cases. They've got to find you, and then it can be really technical, really difficult getting injured people out of those tight canyons and stuff. So signal mirrors are great. Remember how I talked about that foil blanket? Well, from the air, helicopters, planes, they can't see you very well at all. So if you have some bright colors, you know, like on SAR, we wear these bright green shirts, and the helicopters can see us from a long ways. They love it. That's a great strategy. But a signal mirror, man, if you know how to use that, and they happen to be looking at all your way, and you hit them with that reflection of the sun, if you've got some sun in the canyon, can't miss it. They're incredible. So do that. Getting toward the end here. Experience is what you get when you don't have experience. So there are two ways to get experience. You can get trained, or you can go out and live it yourself, and that can be miserable, and it can be deadly. So get some training so you don't get lost, don't go unprepared, you know, water troubles or bring enough water, I guess. Don't be jumping, don't fall and get hurt, and above all, don't die. And now I want to tell you a story. There's so many stories. I'll put some other links on UtahHighways.com. But I want to tell you one that really drives the point home of just how dangerous this is. So let me read you this by Shane Burroughs. The question I'm always asked when people discover I explore canyons in Zion Park is, what happened in Kolob Canyon? If you want the short answer, it would have to be the expedition members did not take the canyon seriously enough. If you would like more details and a longer explanation, then read on. The ensuing story was compiled from various interviews, news conferences, AP news releases, local news releases, personal experience in Kolob Canyon, and other sources. The group of adventurers consisted of 3 men and 5 teenage boys. Explorer scouts from Mormon Church in Salt Lake. The group thought they were well prepared to explore Utah's backcountry. The adventure began as fun and games, but ended in a Utah morgue. Kolob Canyon is unique. An irrigation dam above the canyon controls the stream flow into Kolob. Washington County Water Conservancy District controls the release of the water that flows through the creek into the Virgin River. They release a dribble most of the summer when the canyon would otherwise be dry. The potholes are plunge pools, are always full of clean, clear water and very cold. Before entering Kolob Canyon, the group had camped together many times and practiced basic canyoneering techniques like hiking the streams and climbing rocks with the aid of ropes. The group was well equipped with wetsuits to insulate their bodies from the chilly water of the canyon. They had obtained a permit from Zion Park, the only official agency that handles that. Their 20-year-old leader, David Fletcher, had done the hike twice previously. That's a good idea. the group was very confident in their abilities. On the morning of July 15th, 93, dressed in wetsuits, their gear stored in dry bags, three men, five boys dropped into the canyon. The group rappelled 75 feet into the Kolob Canyon, its deep slot with narrow bends and deep pools of icy water, etc. Almost immediately, the adventurers must have sensed trouble. They had expected some water in the canyon. They had anticipated that hiking the stream bed would require rappelling down a series of waterfalls past plunge pools, but the water was too fast and too deep. Where they had expected it to be ankle deep, it was up to their knees. Down at the bottom, between the walls, all that water was rushing and tugging at them and was very loud. It was difficult to communicate above the noise of the stream. Safe water conditions are considered to be a flow rate of 5 cubic feet per second or less, and the river was flowing at 29 CFS. Fletcher had been concerned about water levels before entering the canyon and had checked with the park officials several times in advance. Once Fletcher got down into the canyon, he was angry that park rangers had not been more clear about the danger. When the men and boys found themselves in such surprisingly high water, Fletcher raged that this was ludicrous that they had been granted a permit. The group kept walking with the current and negotiated several waterfalls and obstacles. Fletcher knew where there might be some dry ground ahead if the hikers could make it past a raging series of four waterfalls. The first waterfall dropped off 8 feet. Fletcher kept the lead, rappelling over the edge, but a whirlpool at the base snared him. Unable to disconnect from his rappel rope with the torrent of water crashing down, Fletcher had little freedom of movement. The boys began yelling that they could see that his backpack strap had slipped around his neck and was choking him. Kim Ellis, 37-year-old, leaped in and managed to free Fletcher from the grip of the whirlpool, but Ellis banged his head on a rock and got sucked to the bottom. The third adult, Mark Brewer, 35 years old, leaped in and managed to wrestle Ellis and himself from the pool. 30 minutes of CPR was futile. Ellis was dead. Two surviving men decided to proceed, which was their only known exit from the canyon. They propped Ellis's body against a log and rigged a rope to lower the boys from the lip of the falls. The first boy lowered was the dead man's 14-year-old son. There was no place to rest as the stunned canyoneers struggled on. The group used ropes to maneuver over two waterfalls. When they reached the fourth falls, they had been in the water 2 hours and had only made 150 feet of downstream progress. The group had lost 6 of their 8 backpacks and much of their rope. The fourth falls was taller, cascading 15 feet. From the rim of the falls, Fletcher tested the force of the whirlpool at its base. He tied a rope to his pack and tossed the pack into the pool. The pack got sucked under and could not be pulled free. Fletcher decided he had to free the pack. He intended to swim the pack to shore where it could serve as a safety anchor for the others. He leaped in, and just when it seemed he had everything under control, the pack slipped and the current sucked him under. There was a long moment as the others stared down into the churning torrent. Fletcher never reappeared. As the last remaining adult, Brewer was left with a very difficult decision, which had to be made immediately. He had to decide whether to stay with the boys or risk himself further by trying to save his friend. The boys were scared, confused, and shivering with cold. Brewer told the boys Fletcher was probably dead. He backed them away from the falls and told them there was no choice. They had to wait where they were and hope for rescue. The group was down to Brewer and the five boys. They pulled rocks from the stream and built a small ledge they could rest on. When fatigue overtook them, they slept piled on each other. Waiting it out for 5 days and 4 nights, they sustained themselves on small rations of raisins, candy, and oatmeal packets. The canyon was 1,300 feet deep and so narrow that they received less than 1 hour of direct sun each day. The group sang songs and prayed against the damp chill. They knew that sooner or later it would be noticed that they were overdue and a search would begin. They had 3 matches and wasted 2 trying to light some driftwood for a signal fire. Helicopters flew over the narrow slot of sky above, and they heard searchers calling. However, no one responded to the group's shouts for help. They used their last match to ignite a signal fire from their salvage supplies, but they were too far down and the smoke wasn't noticed. Late on the afternoon of July 19th, 5 days after entering the canyon, the end of a rope mysteriously snaked down into the pool in front of them. The local SAR team, the local sheriff's office, and Zion National Park had arrived to rescue them. A helicopter shuttle took the group to Zion. Ellis's body was also recovered. Two of the survivors were treated at a local hospital for edema in their legs and feet, which had been brought on by the prolonged wearing of tight wetsuits. Searchers working their way carefully up the canyon bottom didn't locate Fletcher's body until 11 days later. The popular view is that the boys and their three adult leaders were not well enough prepared for the two leaders died because they made mistakes. Zion Park officials maintain the church group was properly informed of the inherent dangers and difficulty of a Kolob Canyon descent. Fletcher's permit was marked with a high danger rating. During periods of high danger, rangers can only recommend against expeditions. Legally, they cannot refuse a permit. Zion Park officials had informed the group that a descent of Kolob would be difficult, dangerous, and time-consuming, which many consider an integral part of the backcountry experience. So, there is your introduction to canyoneering, which I hope you now understand very clearly is killer fun. It's great stuff, but it's dangerous, and you've got to be trained and ready for it. And then once you are, and if you make good choices about where and when to go, you can have a great time. So, there you go. Hope you found that useful.